Okay, good evening, friends. Welcome to a very different and a difficult topic. I'm sure that very few of us are actually exposed to children with cerebral palsy. Particularly in Gujarat, this is not a very common case for postgraduate exam. So very few are actually reading about that. So in this lecture, what I'm going to do is I'm going to give you a brief idea about what is cerebral palsy. And after that, we will take a second lecture about how to examine a child and something important about management. So that in exam, if they ask you, you can answer at least for something. So that's the aim. So if you really want to read more about that, I have written chapters in two textbooks. The one is the Turek textbook of orthopedics. In that, the cerebral palsy chapter is written by me. And then there is another textbook, Indian Orthopedic Association textbook of orthopedics. In that also, the chapter on cerebral palsy is written by me. If you really want to enjoy reading cerebral palsy, then there is a book which is the Help Guide to Cerebral Palsy. It's written by many authors, and I am one of them from India. So this book you can download free from the site www.global-help.org. So this is free and you can read it. It fits a lot of picture and very easy to understand. I have a bad habit, which already Srikunja has told you that I have a bad habit of asking questions. This being a webinar, I have reduced the number of questions, but still I will intermittently, I will go on asking questions. Basically, don't think that I am testing you. The reason of asking question is that I want you to stimulate your thinking, and that is the reason I am asking you question. So let's start with a story of a beautiful couple. There was a fashion designer and an IT engineer. They got married before 5 years. Both were very busy in their profession, and after 5 years, they decided to go for pregnancy to have a child. Unfortunately, they tried for a few years, but at 2 years, they realized that it's not possible naturally. So they decided to go for IVF. And on the first trial, she was really, the IVF was successful and she became pregnant. So the whole family was very jubilant. And on the 7th month, when it was going on, the family celebrated what we call it Khoro Barvo in Gujarati, or in English, we call it baby shower. And the family was really waiting for a new arrival in the family. Unfortunately, on the same day evening, she developed a pain and they had to rush to the hospital. And the doctor said that it's a premature delivery. And the child was born. It was a very low birth weight, premature child. So it was only 7 months. So they decided to keep in ICU. And really, he was fragile. Fortunately, with the help of a neonatologist, in a 5 weeks' time, the boy was healthy. And the doctor said that now you can take him home. When the boy came home, the whole family celebrated the arrival of a new person in the family. At 5 months, the grandmother of a child, whose name is Aryaman, she observed that the child is not developing properly. She has seen other children also. So she is an experienced lady, and she observed that there is something wrong with Aryaman. So next time when they went to pediatrician, they shared their apprehension that something is wrong with Aryaman. The development which should be there is not there. So pediatrician said that no, he is 2 months premature. So that could be the reason of delay. So he gave them advice wait for 2 months. We will see after that. There was no improvement after 2 months. So now the family was really very tense, because it's already 7 months and he was not able to turn from supine to prone, prone to supine. So definitely they realized that. And now you know that the parents can go to the net and find out what is a normal development, and they realize that there is something wrong. So this time pediatrician suggested it's better that we consult neuropediatrician. So the family went to a neuropediatrician. He took the history and he said that let's go for an MRI. And in the MRI, the picture was a periventricular leukomalacia. So I would like to stop at this point and I would ask you, what do we understand by periventricular leukomalacia? Yes, Rikunj, can you unmute them, or like whoever is ready can unmute their speaker and they can answer.
Yes, anybody wants to give answer, you can unmute yourself and you can give answer.
Okay, fine. I understand that this is a slightly specific term. So what we understand by peri means around. Ventricle is like we are talking of the lateral ventricle of the brain. And leukomalacia means there is a white patch in the brain. So if you look at this, the black circle or the black area is in the MRI on the both the side is ventricle. And outside that, where the red arrows are, that's the area which is white, and that's the call it periventricular leukomalacia. You will see this very frequently in MRI, particularly in a cerebral palsy child. And when the family took this MRI to the neuropediatrician, he said that it's cerebral palsy. So now family is really shocked and they don't know what to do. So they have a lot of question about like what is going on, what is cerebral palsy. So they started asking a lot of questions. So now this boy, Aryaman, at the age of 7 months is diagnosed with cerebral palsy. So the first question is, what is cerebral palsy? What do you understand by cerebral palsy? I'm sure that Shrikunj, now some of them should be able to answer this question. What is cerebral palsy?
Yes. Any resident want to answer?
Yes, sir. I want to answer, sir.
Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, please.
Yes, sir. Sir, it's a disorder of particularly movement and posture that happens due to a non-progressive damage in the brain.
Very good.
And the effect, like the musculoskeletal effects, is progressive. But the effect, what is happening in the patient, musculoskeletal and other development, those are progressive. But the damage is non-progressive. That happens before the development of the nervous system.
Yes, very good. So you have covered every important points about the definition of cerebral palsy. So cerebral palsy is a disorders of movement and posture. Movement means activity. The posture is positioning. So there is something wrong in the movement and keeping the body in a particular position. That's sitting, standing. These are basically what we understand by posture. So it's a disorders of movement and posture. The second, the cause of this is damage to the immature brain. So the word immature is very important. And for the sake of research, the word which the immature means a brain which is less than 3 years is called immature brain. We will come to that word immaturity later on when we are talking about the brain development. But the most important thing is it's damage to immature brain. The damage which has taken place in the brain is non-progressive, means it's remained same. The MRI picture which we saw remains like that. It does not progress. On the other end, if you have a condition where MRI is showing a progressive damage or a deterioration, then we should think of some other condition, but not cerebral palsy. However, if you look at the child, the effect of the brain damage, which we see peripherally on the muscles, on the joints, may be progressive. So that's very important. The musculoskeletal effect may be progressive. Brain damage is not progressive. Very good. So the next question is that when does brain damage occur? What do you think?
Around the birth.
Along the so time of birth.
It can be perinatal, antenatal, it can be perinatal, it can be postnatal.
Okay, right. So, yes, there is someone waiting. So, or like someone is trying to answer. Shrikun, someone is waiting probably or like...
No, sir, they are typing message.
Okay. So, they are trying to answer by the message.
Message also. Someone is saying hypoxia.
Okay, that's the cause, but we are talking of when does the brain damage occur. So, like the person who answered is right, like it could be prenatal, before birth. Now, at this point, I shall like to ask you, like in which Hindi movie there was a prenatal cause of damage to the brain?
Koi Mil Gaya.
Very good. Yes, general knowledge is really good. The most common cause is perinatal, means during birth or at the time of birth. And the third cause is postnatal. Of the three, the second one, that's perinatal or during birth, is seen in almost 90 to 95% of the cases. Now, actually, what happens during the birth or at the time of birth, that we need to understand. So that's we are going to have a next question. What are the causes of cerebral palsy? Why does cerebral palsy occur? Yes, you can read the answer also because I'm not trying to read all the answer which they are giving. So if they are answering by chat, you can answer that also.
Sure, sir. I will. Sure.
It is mostly due to hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy.
Okay, very good. So it's a hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy. Yeah, that's the most common cause. Now, let's see the common causes of cerebral palsy. The first is prematurity. We know that at the time when the child is like say 36 to 40 weeks, that's we call it a mature child. At that case, the brain has developed a reasonably good resistance to hypoxia. The premature brain is not very resistant to hypoxia. So slightest amount of hypoxia will lead to damage and that results into cerebral palsy. So prematurity is a most common cause. The second one is a low birth weight. There are various reasons of a low birth weight and one of that we are going to see later in a minute. So the third cause is what he said is hypoxia. Now, there is a change in the reason. Before 15 years, 20 years, hypoxia was most common cause in our country. However, because development of the neonatology and government insistent that the delivery should happen only in presence of doctor, the hypoxia has now become a less common cause. So now it is at number three. Now, why hypoxia leads to brain damage? Or let me tell you, let me ask you other way. Whenever we are discussing about the cardiac arrest, it's taught to us that it's very important to start the heart pumping very soon. What is the reason for that? Why we insist that? When we are talking of a cardiopulmonary resuscitation, CPR, we say that it should be as quick as possible. Why?
Brain is more responsible to hypoxia.
Okay. So it's believed that I think probably no one has really tested it, but it's believed that the brain can remain without oxygen for 5 minutes. Brain does not have any oxygen reservoir. So brain constantly need oxygen and brain can remain without oxygen for 5 minutes. That 5 minutes is much less or that period is much less in a premature child and a child with a low birth weight. So hypoxia is a very common cause of brain damage in these children. Hypoglycemia, again, brain needs glucose for its functioning. And when glucose is not given to a newborn child, they develop hypoglycemia and that results into a global damage to the brain. The multiple pregnancy is nowadays very common. why we see a lot of patients are not, or like the couple with multiple pregnancy. Can anyone answer that question?
Because of the in vitro fertilization.
Yeah, so IVF is one of the reasons of multiple pregnancy. And when there is multiple pregnancy, it's very common that either both or one of the child will be with a low birth weight. So multiple pregnancy leads to another problem, that's a low birth weight, and that increases the possibility of having a brain damage. Then neonatal jaundice was probably one significant factor before few years. When there is a jaundice and when the serum bilirubin increases beyond certain extent, the bilirubin will go to the basal ganglia and will get deposited over there, and that will result into a permanent damage of that area, and that results into one typical type of cerebral palsy. Fortunately, now we are going for early blood exchange transfusion, and because of that we have reduced the possibility or the incidence of neonatal jaundice related cerebral palsy. And the last is infection to mother, particularly a torch infection to a mother, or infection to a child later on after the birth, can also be cause of cerebral palsy. So these are the common cause. Please don't go with the idea that these seven are the only reasons of cerebral palsy and there is no other factor or other cause beyond that. These are common cause. Any question related to this before we move on? If they want to understand more, then...
Question, sir.
Yeah, please.
Sir, you said that by 3 years of age, a child is supposed to be called as an immature brain. So do injuries which occur when hypoxia occurs in 1 or 2 years of age, so are CP changes possible after that age group, or it is around perinatal age only?
Yes, a good question. So like by definition, any insult to a brain, whether it's a hypoxia, whether it's because of the drowning, because of the infection, because of any other reason, the cardiac arrest in a child, if brain damage or hypoxia occurs to a child before 3 years, yes, it's come under the category of cerebral palsy.
Thank you, sir.
Sir, one question is there, sir.
Yeah, please.
Sir, you told the cause is periventricular leukomalacia. So what happens if there is a periventricular hemorrhage?
Okay, right. So that's another thing also. So whenever there is a hemorrhage, that hemorrhage will result into a damage to the adjacent area of brain. Now, whenever there is a brain damage, the brain will always heal by fibrosis. Brain tissue cannot be regenerated, right? So whatever hemorrhage occurs, ultimately that will result into a fibrosis or a scar formation. And the area adjacent to that hemorrhage will undergo pressure necrosis and will have a fibrosis or the death of the neural tissue in that area. So periventricular hemorrhage is also one of the mechanism of periventricular leukomalacia. Periventricular leukomalacia is the end result. It may be because of the hemorrhage, it may be because of hypoxia. But what we see is the end result, that's a scarring in the area adjacent to ventricle. That's the periventricular leukomalacia. Clear or any question?
Sir, one more question, sir.
Yeah, please. Please.
Yeah, sir, if we get, can we say a child, we get in an OPD below the age of 2 years, if he's having a features like of delayed milestones, and we come to know that these are the like probable features of the cerebral palsy. So should we consider or should we consider that child a case of cerebral palsy before the age of 2 years, or we can say that it is a case of delayed milestone?
Okay, that's a very good question. And I think we will come to that question in the later part of the lecture. So if I don't answer that point in my lecture, please ask me this question again, right?
Okay.
Yeah, because the last few slides are related to what you asked me. So we are going to discuss that in the later part.
Okay, right? Sir.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay, so now we come to the effect of brain damage because of hemorrhage, because of ischemia, because of infection, because of abscess, whatever has happened, but ultimately there is a brain damage. And what are the effects of this brain damage that we are going to see next? So let me ask a question. If you look at a comparison of elephant and a human, elephant is much more bigger in size. Similarly, if you look at the comparison of human and rhino, the size of the rhino is much more than that of a human. Still, why we are smaller in size, we are able to rule over the animal kingdom?
Sir, it's a percentage of brain weight according to body weight.
Yes, so, that's very important. Like, see, it's because of the brain power we are ruling over the animal kingdom. It's not the size, but it's the size of the brain relation with your body weight. That's very important. And the point is, like, whatever we are at this stage, no doubt for last 3 months, we have realized that we had a lot of ego about our power. But with a tiny organism, that ego has really vanished. So the reason of our strength or the strength of the mankind is because of the brain power. Now, what happens, like, when we are born, the size of the brain has a limitation. The size of a brain which we have as an adult compared to the body weight. If we have the similar proportion of the brain, then head will be so big that it cannot come out through the female pelvis. So what nature has designed is, like, brain, when it comes out, it's smaller in size. It's not fully developed. In the first 3 to 7 years, the 75% of the development of the brain occurs after the child is outside the uterus. You can see that if I give you a one common example, if you see a dog on the street, how fast they start walking after the birth. If you look at the baby dog or the Galudia, how fast they start walking. Can anyone say from the experience? Which day? Third day, fourth day, fifth day, or after 2 months, 3 months?
Third day, sir.
Yeah, so usually on the 3rd to 7th day, the dog starts walking. On the other end, the human takes 1 year to walk. The reason is because when we are born, our brain is not fully mature. It matures later on during the first 3 years of life. And that's why our milestones, the motor milestone, they are gradually coming. Right now, in cerebral palsy, this brain development is affected. So the child is born only with 25% of the brain power. The 75% of the development is going to take place later on. At the time of birth, that whatever brain power they have, of that, some of the brain is affected. And that affects the development which is going to take place later on. How that development is affected, that we are going to see now. So when we talk of cerebral palsy, there are two type of effects, or we can call it impairment. The one is motor related to movement, that's a walking or the hand activity. And second is non-motor, which is not related to walking. So in every cerebral palsy child, there are two type of effects. The one is motor effect or impairment, and the second is non-motor impairment. What is non-motor impairment? That we will see later on. But let's focus on one which is very important, that's a motor impairment. Because most of the children which we are dealing from orthopedic surgeon's perspective, we are going to improve their motor impairment. We are going to take care of their walking and their hand function. So let's focus first on motor. Okay, so coming back to the figure of periventricular leukomalacia, I said that the brain which is adjacent to the ventricle, the periventricular area, has undergone a fibrosis, and that's seen as a leukomalacia on the brain. Now, how does it affect a child? Let's see that. If you take a cut section in a different plane, now we are looking in the frontal cut section, what we see in the center, can you see this cursor, or It's not possible.
No, sir. We can see it, sir. We can see.
Yeah. So that is the ventricle. Now, what we see, which important area or the neural structure is lying on the side of that ventricle? Can you see the figure and tell me? It's already there in the figure. Yes.
Yes. Anybody? Yes. Residents, please give answers.
Thalamus is here.
Okay, someone said thalamus. Okay, then what else?
Corpus callosum.
Yes, very good. Yeah, the correct answer is a corticospinal tract. If you look at this tract, right, that's a corticospinal tract. They are starting up, starting from the motor cortex, and then they carry fiber downwards towards the spinal cord. That's the corticospinal tract. That's the important for us. Now, when we say a periventricular leukomalacia, this part of the brain is affected. So first and the most important, it affects corticospinal tract, and later on it affects this part, which we call it basal ganglia. So, and sometimes it affects thalamus, but thalamus is not mainly affected. It's basically this part, the corticospinal tract or a pyramidal tract, and the area which is by the side is called extrapyramidal part. So this part is usually affected in cerebral palsy. Okay, so now let's come to the next question. Whenever we see a child, whenever this area is affected, the corticospinal tract or the extrapyramidal system, it results into altered tone. The most common is spasticity. When corticospinal tract is affected, it results into spasticity. When extrapyramidal system is involved, it results into dystonia, means a changing tone. Spasticity means tone is exaggerated, hypertonia. Dystonia is changing. Then we have a smaller cases like athetoid, ataxic, or sometimes there is a combination of two. One which is important, I would like to say that spasticity is a most important for orthopedic surgeon, because the remaining four, that's a dystonia, athetoid, ataxia, we cannot do anything from orthopedic point of view. Whatever we can offer these children is because of the effect of spasticity. So spasticity is the most important one from orthopedic surgeon's point of view. So let's understand something about spasticity. The question is, why do these children have spasticity?
Yes, anybody please give answers.
Because of
cerebral cortex.
Continuous passive stretch reflex. There is no control over the stretch reflex of muscles.
Why? Why there is no control?
Because of the pyramidal tract involved.
Pyramidal tract involved. The gamma motor neuron, the inhibitory control is deficient.
Yes, very good. That's very important. Basically, they have a spasticity because of the loss of inhibitory control from higher center. We already saw that the corticospinal tract is involved. How does it affect or result into spasticity? We are looking at the cut section of a spinal cord, and we are talking of a lower reflex. This is a efferent pathway. The green one is the efferent pathway. And then the red one is efferent pathway, which goes to the muscle. Usually this spinal reflex arc is in an exaggerated tone, which I have shown as a red over here. That's the efferent pathway, which is already exaggerated. In a normal person, there is an inhibitory control coming from the higher center via corticospinal tract like this. So when there is an inhibitory control from higher centers, the tone is normal. Now, when there is a damage to the corticospinal tract, as we already saw, because of the periventricular leukomalacia, this inhibitory control is lost. So when this control is lost, automatically the lower reflex, spinal reflex arc gets into the original exaggerated or excited stage. And that results into spasticity. Okay, so we saw the reason of why there is spasticity. Now we are coming to the next question. What are the signs of spasticity? Whenever we see a child of cerebral palsy, how can we make that there is a spasticity? Spasticity is nothing but exaggerated tone. So usually when you examine the jerks, like the knee jerk or the ankle jerk, they are exaggerated. Sometimes there is a clonus. Now, coming to the point, like how this spasticity actually causes problem to a child. Now we are talking of a child who is 7 or 8 months. His brain is trying to learn few things. So now this, how this spasticity is going to cause problem to this child?
Yes, anybody?
Spasticity leads to the altered muscle balance towards joints. I mean, there is an antagonist and agonist muscle balance is lost in the joint.
Okay, right. Fine. Okay, so how I look at the spasticity? Suppose there is a door and the door has a hinges. Now, if these hinges are well lubricated, in that case, the movement of the door will be smooth. Now, if these hinges are not lubricated, if they are rusted, in that case, what will happen? If you try to open or close the door, there will be a lot of resistance. The same thing happens in the case of spasticity. Whenever child tries to carry out a movement, because of the spasticity, there is an increased resistance. So he or she has to really work hard to move the joint. Then because of the spasticity, some muscles are very active. And because of that, the body assumes abnormal position. So let's talk of a such exaggerated response or the spasticity in a calf muscles. If calf is very spastic, what will happen when child tries to stand?
Flexed attitude of the knee.
Equinus will be present.
Yes, there will be equinus because of the exaggerated spasticity or just because of the spasticity, the calf muscles will go into a contraction and that will result into plantar flexion of the ankle or a equinus position. Similarly, if hamstrings, they go into overactivity or spasticity, what will be the change in the posture?
Flexion at knee.
Flexion at knee. And if we talk of adductors at the hip, what will be the position?
Please reduction.
Caesaring, sir.
Caesaring. Yes. So now already you have understood the reason because of spasticity in adductors, there is caesaring. Because of spasticity in the hamstring, there is a knee flexion. Because of spasticity in the calf muscle or the gastrosoleus muscle, there is an equinus. Good. So now, coming to the most important thing is the long-term effect of spasticity. Here, where the role of orthopedic surgeon is in the picture. The problem started with brain damage. That results into periventricular leukomalacia. That results into spasticity. Now, what happens to this spastic muscles over a period of time? This spastic muscles over a period of time, they go for a contracture. Contracture is a muscle shortening. Now, we are going to understand how this spastic muscles, they go or they result into contracture. Before that, let me ask you a question. This is the question which we are trying to understand, that how does spasticity lead to muscle contracture? The question is, how does muscle increase their length over years? So let me tell you, like suppose a child is 1 year. From 1 year when child becomes 3 year, the bones are going to increase in length. we know that there is growth plate at both the ends, and because of that, the bone increase its length. Proportionately, the muscle also has to elongate. So now the question is that how does muscle elongate?
Sir, for a muscle to grow, it has to stretch.
And yes. So that's a very important thing. For muscles to grow in length, it has to be stretched. When muscles are stretched, it gets the signal that now I have to elongate. Right? So when or how these muscles are stretched, when children are playing, they are carrying various activities. At that time, various muscles are stretched, and that stretch gives a signal to the muscle that now you have to elongate. Okay, so now you have understood about the normal children. What happens in cerebral palsy? Can anyone tell me now what happens to cerebral palsy?
The bone cerebral growth. Palsy.
Yeah, no. Yes.
In cerebral palsy, the anti-gravity muscles are more spastic than the antagonists.
Right.
So and the antagonists are not powerful enough to stretch the spastic anti-gravity muscles. So which is why they don't get stretched, and hence, but the skeletal growth is happening. So relative right. to the bone, the muscle remains short.
Yes, very good. So exactly the same thing happens. Now the one thing which I would like to add is there is a characteristics of spasticity. When there is a spastic muscles, when you stretch, there is an exaggerated stretch reflex. So normal muscles on stretching get relaxed, while spastic muscle will not relax, but on the other end, it would contract. So it would become short. So a normal stretch mechanism, which is helping a normal child to elongate its muscle, is not working in cerebral palsy, because as soon as there is a stretch on the muscle will contract, it will become short. So now muscle is not getting a stretch signal, and because of that, it fails to elongate. On the other end, muscle, they don't need such stretch signals. They elongate automatically at the growth plate. So bone continues to elongate, the muscles, they fail to elongate. And that is the reason they go for contracture. So the message is spastic muscles, they fail to elongate during the growing years. And that is one of the reasons that it leads to contracture. And most of the orthopedic surgery which we are doing is basically to take care of the contracture which has developed. So to understand that, I am giving you an example. I am showing you a leg muscle, a leg. On the front, there is the tibia fibula and the ankle joint and a foot. On the back, what we see is a green color, that is a normal muscle. We are talking first of a normal person. In a normal person with age, there is an increase in the bone length. Exactly proportionate to that, the muscle will also elongate. And that will result into a normal position of the foot. On the other end, let's see what happens in spastic muscles. This in spastic patient, the bone has elongated. However, muscles, they don't elongate proportionately. They remain short. Now compare this second and the third, and you will see that the muscle length is less. And that results into a plantar flexion or equinus contracture. So spasticity results into contracture, and contracture leads to a joint deformity. So this is what the sequence is. Because of the brain damage, there is a spasticity. Spasticity results into muscle contracture. Muscle contracture leads to joint deformity. Let me ask you, like, how much is clear till now? Any confusion?
Yes. Sir, I have a question. Like, yes. If the muscles are in a constant stage of spasticity, so is it possible that they will go into flaccidity sometime due to the exhaustion of the neuromuscular transmitters? And like another thing is that in if a patient comes to us with paralysis which is of flaccid type, so can we tell that this is a patient of cerebral palsy? Because like most of the patient what we encounter is of spastic type of cerebral palsy. So sir, please clarify on that point, sir.
Yes, a very good question. Flaccidity or hypotonia, what we call it, is seen only in 1% of the cerebral palsy. Remaining large group, 80 to 90%, they are spastic variety. So that's a larger group. The question what you ask is like the flaccid variety or a hypotonic variety, they don't go for contracture, they don't go for joint deformity. It's only the spastic cases, they undergo muscle contracture and joint deformity. On the other end, if you look at a dystonic variety where the tone is changing, they also don't develop muscle contracture or joint deformity. Right? So it's basically, I said that of the various types, we are, as an orthopedic surgeon, focusing only on spasticity, spastic variety, because those spastic patients are going to have muscle contracture and joint deformity. Flaccid, they will not come to us for orthopedic treatment. They will have different set of problems, but they will not have muscle contracture, they will not have a joint deformity. Similarly, dystonic will also not have a muscle contracture, they will not have a joint deformity. Clear okay. Or still the question is there?
No, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yeah. Okay, so now coming to the question. It's not that all muscles are going to behave same. There are few muscles which are very peculiar in cerebral palsy and they are likely to become short. And those muscles are the adductors. The second is hamstrings, that's knee flexors. The third is gastrocnemius, which is ankle plantar flexors. And the fourth is iliopsoas, which is hip flexors. So these are the muscles. Please remember that these are the muscles which are going to have the maximum effect of spasticity, and they are likely to become short over a period of time. Now, one question is, what is common to all these muscles?
So they are biarticular muscles.
Crosses two joints.
Yes, very good. They are biarticular muscles. They cross two joints. So now the one important thing is biarticular muscles are more affected in cerebral palsy, spastic variety of cerebral palsy. Don't ask me the question why, because I also don't know the reason why. But we have seen that the spasticity has a more affinity or more affection for a biarticular muscles, and it will show its effect more predominantly in the four muscles which we discuss, because they are biarticular muscles. There are various theories for that, but none of the theory is yet proved, and probably we cannot prove that, but there are various hypotheses which we are not going to discuss at this stage, because that's not important for you. But what is more important for you is like the four muscles, biarticular muscles, are more affected in cerebral palsy. The second problem in this patient is weakness. Now, a lot of doctors have a confusion between spasticity and weakness. Spasticity is basically, we are talking of the tone. Weakness, we are talking of the force. The ability of muscles to generate power, that is we are discussing, and that is less in cerebral palsy. Now the question is, why there is weakness in cerebral palsy?
One, because of the contractures, that would be the shortening.
Okay, but that's a contracture is basically a length phenomena. The muscle length has become less. We are talking of a power.
Sir, it is due to
fatigue, sir.
Involvement of corticospinal tract.
Yes, that's the very important thing. See, basically, when we are talking of a involvement of corticospinal tract, it's a upper motor neuron type of paralysis. And upper motor neuron lesions, one of the feature of UMN lesion is weakness. So weakness in cerebral palsy is because of the lesion which is in the brain or because of the corticospinal tract involvement. The second thing is, compared to normal children, they have a delayed development. And muscle always respond on to the stimulus which is given to them, that's the activity. So compared to normal children, cerebral palsy children are less active. And because of that, their muscles are not getting stimulation for the increase in the muscle fiber, and that results into weakness. Then some of the children, they have a problem of eating or swallowing, and that results into malnutrition, and that is an additional factor for weakness. Then there is the fourth one, which is iatrogenic, means our treatment which we are offering them, that results into a weakness. There are two treatments for which we are really worried about. Is one is a botulinum treatment. It takes care of the spasticity, but of late we have realized that it leads to or exaggerate the weakness component. So on one side it is helping, but on other side it is causing more problem. And the second treatment which we are offering very enthusiastically to our patient is we are giving them ankle foot orthosis. So when we give ankle foot orthosis, we are giving them some sort of removable plaster so that they can't carry out movement at the ankle joint. And when you give a plaster to any patient, when we remove the plaster, we know that the muscles which are immobilized, they become weak. So similarly, when we give them ankle foot orthosis for long period, their all muscles, they also become weak. So these are the causes of weakness. Now, what will be the effect of weakness? How these children, they will tell us about weakness?
They will have some poor balance, or they can't, they don't have a proper control over the muscles.
Okay, see, that's a different thing. The muscle control is different. We are talking of a weakness, and weakness present as easy fatigability. After walking few steps, they will get tired, they will get exhausted because their muscle don't have a stamina or endurance because they are weak. So that's one thing. And the second thing is already, like I said, that they have a less endurance. So what they complain after standing for a few minutes, they will say that I just want to sit. The reason is because now the muscles which are helping the body to remain upright, now they have become fatigued, and now they say that now I want rest. And because of that, the person or a child says that now I want to sit or I want to lie down. So easy fatigability is one of the feature of weakness. Sometimes it leads to change in posture that we are not discussing at this stage. We will see later on. The third point I just would like to tell you about, that because of the upper motor neuron lesion, they have a defective selective motor control. What is selective motor control? If I want to move my finger like this, I have a good selective motor control. But if you ask a cerebral palsy child to move this, when they will try to move one finger, the other fingers will also move. In some case, when they try to move fingers, it's not only the fingers move, but the wrist or the elbow also moves. So that's called a lack of selective motor control or deficient selective motor control. So three things: the spasticity, weakness, and the deficient selective motor control, that leads to a problem in movement or the motor component. Okay, so before we go on to the known motor impairment, any question related to this about the motor problem? Everything clear? Okay, so now let's go to the last part of the impairment, That's the known motor impairment. For or as an orthopedic surgeon, this is not area where we are going to do anything. But it significantly affects the child, and at least we should know about those known motor impairment. The first is a lot of these children, they have a speech problem. They can't communicate well. They have a swallowing problem. They can't swallow the food properly. Some of the children, when they try to swallow, they will have a regurgitation or aspiration in the lungs. So that's because of the muscles which is controlling the swallowing or the deglutition. They are also affected, like the skeletal muscles. Some of them have a cognition impairment, or what we call it low IQ. Then additionally, some of the children have a vision problem, means they can't see properly, or sometimes they have a squint. So the two eyes, they are not focusing on an object, but it is looking at a different direction. So that is another problem. And many of the cerebral palsy children, they have a scarring in the brain, and that scar works as a focus or the nidus. And from that, the abnormal electrical signals, they are generated, and that results into seizures. So these are the additional problem of these children. We are not going to do anything for that, but at least we should be aware about this problem. So these known motor impairments, their magnitude varies according to patient. However, they definitely increase the disability of a child. There is a problem in walking, but all this problem which we discuss, they increase the difficulty of parents or the family members and also of a child. Okay, so now the question is, how these children, they present to us? We saw that there is a problem of spasticity, there is a problem in the development. So now, how do they present to us? Now, before we discuss about presentation, let us understand that what we discuss is only the pathophysiology, but the presentation varies according to the magnitude of damage to the brain. If large area of brain is affected, then child will be a completely non-ambulatory and will be a wheelchair bound. On the other end, if there is a child who has a minimal brain damage, the child will be able to walk with a very small abnormality or a difference. So the presentation of cerebral palsy children varies according to the severity of brain damage. So the presentation can be at early age. Those who are less than 2, they present to us with a delayed development. At 2 to 4, they come to us with an abnormal walking. Normal child should walk by 15 months, right? So up to 15 months, we are not able to say that this is cerebral palsy, but we just say that it is delayed development. And they come to us with a delayed development. I'm not taking you into the normal development, motor development, like turning or the controlling the head, turning from supine to prone, prone to supine, crawling. I'm not taking you into those milestones, but all these milestones will be delayed. Usually child should be able to walk by the age of 1.5, but in cerebral palsy, this walking is delayed. And even they start walking, it will be abnormal. So either they come to us as a delayed walking, or a minimally affected children will come to us with an abnormal walking. So this is a child who is 2 years. By 2 years, child should be able to walk unsupported normally. If you look at in this, this child is walking with abnormal walking, and his father has to support. So this is one of the gait pattern which we call it in, we see very frequently in cerebral palsy, that's a seizure gait. This is another abnormal walking pattern where child is walking on toes, right? So heel is not touching during the stance phase and it's keeping the heel up all throughout the stance phase. So this is another abnormal gait pattern. The second thing is like, in addition to delayed walking, abnormal walking, sometimes they need support while walking. So some children, they need support while walking. Then there is a pattern which we call it a hemiplegic variety of cerebral palsy, in which there is an asymmetrical pattern. And usually they come to us with that child is using one hand properly, but he is not using the other extremity. So that is another way of presentation. Or sometimes they, the minimally affect children, they will come to us with a complaint that when he's walking slow, rest of the thing are normal, but his or her elbow go into flexion. So that's a mild variety of cerebral palsy, but that's a typical feature of cerebral palsy. And it is because of the spasticity in the biceps muscle, which results into elbow flexion while walking. Now, if you examine, you will see the signs of spasticity, and that will be exaggerated reflexes or increased tone. When you try to carry out movement, you will feel resistance at the various joints, and exaggerated dip or the tendon reflexes or a plantar reflex. These are the signs which we elicit. Then the later on, like say after 2 years, 3 years, you may look at some of the signs of muscle shortening. Which muscles are likely to become short?
Same biarticular muscles.
Yes, biarticular muscles. So when we are talking of, or when we are examining for muscle shortening, we need to assess all the four biarticular muscles which we discuss. That's adductor, iliopsoas, hamstrings, and gastrosoleus. So we need to look at their length. How to assess that we will see in the subsequent lecture. But during clinical examination, we should look for the muscle length or muscle shortening. And also we need to look for the joint deformity. The joints of the lower extremity, that is hip, are affected, knees are having a flexion deformity, or ankle is having plantar flexion deformity. So we need to look for this deformity. I will explain you how to look for muscle shortening and joint deformity in the subsequent lecture. Okay, so now coming to the question, how the diagnosis is made. And someone asked me the question about the diagnosis of delayed development. So I will try to answer that. So before the advent of MRI, we had no investigation which can see inside the brain. So at that point, from clinical examination, from history, from presentation, we used to say that, yes, child may be cerebral palsy. And we used to say that it could be a case of cerebral palsy. So till the age of 2 years, we used to say it's delayed development. And after 2 years, when there are more signs, we used to say that this is cerebral palsy. Now, the trend has completely changed. We have an investigation which can tell us about a lot of things about brain. And at 7 months also, when we see a periventricular leukomalacia, definitely we can now stamp the diagnosis of cerebral palsy early. So what someone asked me is right, before the advent of MRI, we used to say delayed development till 2 years. And after 2 years, we used to stamp it as cerebral palsy. But now that has changed with the availability of MRI. We can say the diagnosis of cerebral palsy very early. Now the question is how the diagnosis is made. The diagnosis of cerebral palsy is made by three things. The first is a history, which is suggestive of cerebral palsy. So there has to be some predisposing factors. What are the predisposing factors? What are the predisposing factors for cerebral palsy?
Prematurity, multiple birth,
hypoxic damage.
Yes.
Low birth weight.
Preeclampsia.
Yes, so all the seven factors that's which we same, saw, they are basically the history which is suggestive of cerebral palsy. Now, how do you ask about hypoxia?
Sir, by asking ki bachche ko delivery ke baad ICU ki zarurat padi thi kya?
Crying at birth.
Yeah, so that is one thing. The second thing is about asking about the crying. The second is like crying. Whether the child has become blue or not. Right, so these are the ways by which we try to identify about hypoxia. Now, many a times the child is kept in NICU and parents have not seen the child at all. But when there is a history that child was kept in ICU, that itself is sufficient to understand that child was critical, was probably premature or a low birth weight, or is having probably a hypoxic event. And because of that, child was kept in NICU. So when there is a history of NICU admission, that again suggests that this could be a cerebral palsy. So the first is a predisposing factor that we look at from history. The second is there is a delayed development or abnormal walking. So that's the presenting symptoms. And the third is on examination, there is a spasticity. There is a muscle contracture of a biarticular muscles. When all these are matching, we can make a diagnosis of cerebral palsy. When all the three are matching on a clinical ground, we can definitely say that this is cerebral palsy. We don't need MRI in all the patients. However, when we are not sure about this, when history is not there, when symptoms are not suggestive of a delayed development, or when signs are not matching. In that case, it's always better to go for investigation. And which investigation we suggest?
MRI.
Yes, MRI brain is the investigation which we need to make a diagnosis of cerebral palsy. Right, so I think I stop at this point. If you have any question, I think it's already exactly 1 hour. So if you have any question, please feel free to ask me.
Yes, anybody having question regarding investigations, pathophysiology of cerebral palsy, please proceed.
So...
Yeah.
Am I audible, sir?
Yeah, please.
Sir, other than MRI, if a child of comes with a scissoring gait, what X-ray should we go for? Hip X-rays, sir?
Okay, that I'm going to discuss later on.
So, okay,
sir. What today discuss is about the pathophysiology, about the making a diagnosis.
Okay.
We are not discussing how to assess a child of cerebral palsy, which is important for you in the long case examination, in the practical examination, that's important, that we are going to discuss in the next, and whether to go for a pelvis X-ray or when to go for pelvis X-ray, that we will discuss in the subsequent lecture.
Okay, sir.
Anybody else want to ask a question to sir?
No question. Everything clear or everything went above the head?
No, sir. Everything is clear. You have made everything clear. It was a very nice and detailed lecture.
Sir, one question is there, sir.
Yes, please.
Sir, a child less than 2 years old.
Mm-hmm.
So, with the delayed milestones, can we label it as a CP or is there any... how to diagnose in a child less than 2 years old, sir?
Okay, see, I already answered that question, but again, I will repeat because that's the question which you had asked earlier also. If history is there suggestive of cerebral palsy, if presenting symptoms are delayed development, already you said about that, and the child has a spasticity, we can make a provisional diagnosis of cerebral palsy. But if you are not sure, in that case, go for the MRI of brain, even though child is less than two, And MRI will, if MRI shows a periventricular leukomalacia, then yes, we can make a diagnosis of cerebral palsy in a child even less than 2 years.
Thank you, sir.
Dhiren?
Yes, sir.
Two things. I think you will cover that. Coordination also is one of the role, but the child has to be a little understandable to examine.
I didn't get you, sir. Yeah.
Coordination of the muscles, where we do a testing of the coordination.
Yeah, okay. So that's very important. Like, see, one of the problem in cerebral palsy is that we will come to when we come to examination.
Yes, yes.
If you ask a child to carry out a particular movement, the normal IQ child will understand and will help us in carrying out that movement. Now, the cerebral palsy, one of the known motor impairment is cognition impairment, that's a low IQ. And because of that, they will not be able to understand what we are trying to say. And because of that, they will not be able to carry out that particular examination. So active examination is very less in cerebral palsy. It's mainly the passive examination done by examiner that is very important in cerebral palsy. That's the reason is because we don't expect support from the child or the coordination of a child. And the second thing is that selective motor control is affected. So whatever they want to carry out, their movement will not be smooth like a normal child. It will be haphazard, it would be jerky.
Second important thing, how reliable plantars in a small child? Because if you have to diagnose below 2 years, because we will more rely on the plantars.
Yeah, it's definitely reliable because it's one of the sign of upper motor neuron. So that's a very reliable sign because that will add on to the one point of spasticity.
Because in an immature child, that may not be. But with these children, definitely this is a positive sign of a plantar extensors.
Yeah, exactly. So that's a very important sign. And like either we look at the deep tendon reflex, that's a knee jerk or the ankle jerk, or we look at the plantar, and that will definitely give us an important clue about upper motor neuron type of lesion. Yes, so that's a very important thing. And easy to carry out.
That's a very easy to carry
very
out.
Very easy to carry out. I told,
this must be very quick. It's very quick, which we should do it.
Yes, anybody else want to ask question to sir?
Sir, any role of genetic disorders in cerebral palsy as a cause of genetic cerebral palsy, sir?
Yes, that's a very small cause. The genetic cause is one of the reason. But please understand that genetic cause are of two type. The one is a progressive cause where the brain damage gradually go on increasing. So those type of genetic disorders, they are not included in cerebral palsy because according to the definition of cerebral palsy, it's a static encephalopathy or a brain damage which has occurred is not going to progress. So those genetic disorders where brain damage is usually genetic disorders, gradually the brain damage is increasing. So they don't come under the category of cerebral palsy. However, there may be a one or two conditions, genetic conditions, which may be considered as a cerebral palsy.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Thank you, Dhiren. Thank you,
sir.
Thank you.
Good night. Thank you so much, sir.
Dhiren, sir.
Yes.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, sir. The next lecture we are planning is about examination, and you are going to include management in that lecture, sir, or we need to have separate lecture of management?
I think that what I'm expecting that 1 hour will take about various things which orthopedic surgeon should know about cerebral palsy, about the assessment. So
yes,
I would like to say about the GMFCS, which is very important thing in decision making. So yes, I will tell about the GMFCS. I will explain what are the muscles we need to examine, how to examine.
Yes, sir.
And then if time permits, we will start about the management. So what I will do is like, let me first of all prepare my lecture. So from that, I will realize that how much material I have.
Yes.
And accordingly, if time is there, then we will start with management. And whatever we can finish in that lecture, we will try to finish. And the rest of the thing, we will take later on.
Absolutely, sir. Absolutely. And one thing I want to say, sir, during my residency, I have attended many PG classes. I have listened many CP lectures also, but I have not seen anything like this, sir.
Okay, thank you. Exactly,
first time, sir, even I have understood the CP. Otherwise, I never got from anywhere, like reading books or seeing lectures. This was the simplest yet extensive.
Thank you.
And thank you for your efforts and thank you very much for your time, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Yeah. Okay.
Good night.
Good night, sir.
Good night, sir.
Good night. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir.